We have the professor's presentation in the discipline of biotechnology, molecular biology and biotechnology, biochemistry, biotechnology, and plant physiology. So there are three disciplines which are covered under the School of Basic Sciences. And there are total 32 theses on which the presentations will be made altogether, and constituting 18 MSc and 14 PhD students. So the work of these MSc and PhD students will be presented during this session. And this is only a representative part of the total research work being carried out at these disciplines. So with these words, once again, I welcome you all on this fourth session of the program. And I would like to request our Honorable Director, Dr. A.K. Singh, to kindly introduce the chairperson of this basic sciences, Dr. T.R. Sharma. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rasmi. And I would like to extend a warm welcome to Dr. T.R. Sharma, Dr. Prasad, who is going to chair the next session, and all my colleagues, professors who are going to make the presentation of respective discipline, all the students. I can see about 400 presently with us who have joined online. It's my pleasure to introduce to this August gathering the distinguished chair of this program, Dr. T.R. Sharma, presently our Deputy Director General of Crop Science. Dr. Sharma did his PhD from HPKVV, Palampur. And he worked on induction and transfer of resistance to alternaria blight of mustard. He did his postdoc at University of Alberta, and then joined back the university as assistant professor, and then subsequently moved on to National Research Center on Plant Biotechnology here as senior scientist, or as principal scientist, and participated in the genome sequencing project, particularly leading role played by him in the bioinformatics component on RISE genome sequencing, where he also had participation with the Cold Spring Harbor laboratory. And after coming back, he has been instrumental in sequencing many crop genome species with Professor N.K. Singh and Dr. Mahapatra. Dr. Sharma also served as executive director of NABI, National Agri-Food Biotechnology, where he brought complete transformation of institute in terms of its translational research with critical manpower. He trained them, and the institute is doing very well in terms of publication output and so on. At IRI, his research work was focused on blast resistance in rice, and his pioneering work on cloning of gene PI54 is monumental work, which has been now deployed in the breeding program. Number of varieties carrying this gene have been released for commercial cultivation. We also had very in-depth association on an NAIP project for developing isogenic lines of blast-resistant genes in the background of Pusa Basmati 1. And some of these varieties were released as product. Dr. Sharma has the rare distinction of being a fellow of the All Science Academies of India. That includes our own academy, National Academy of Agricultural Sciences, National Academy of Sciences India at Allahabad, Indian National Science Academy, New Delhi, and Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore. So that's a rare distinction that very few scientists in the agricultural stream that have, which Dr. Sharma has. And his contribution has been widely recognized by several awards. And these include ICR Young Scientist Award, DVT National Bioscience Award, Boswick Award, and Rafi Mercury Award. So it's indeed my pleasure to welcome Dr. Sharma to chair the session on basic sciences, where the professor of respective disciplines are going to make the presentation on significant research finding of students. We had a presentation of IRI Merit Medal and Best Student Medal yesterday and day before yesterday. So as you are aware, one student from each discipline presented their work there. But for the remaining students, the professors are going to present significant findings from those. With that, I would like to welcome each one of you and request Dr. Seema Jaggi to proceed further. Seema.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Good afternoon to all of you and welcome to this post-lunch session and especially to this session of presentation of School of Basic Sciences Disciplines. Special welcome to our chairperson, Dr. T.R. Sharma, sir. Most welcome to this session, sir. We have three presentations in this session. First one is by Professor Anil Dahuja from the discipline of biochemistry.
Honorable chairperson of the session, respected director IRI, dean and joint director of education, and other esteemed members of the IRI fraternity, I welcome you all to my presentation. I'm going to present the significant educational achievements of the discipline of biochemistry made during the year 2020. Before actually moving on to the research findings and academic accomplishments of the students and faculty members, I would like to give you a brief overview of the divisions. We have a total of 12 faculty members and 31 postgraduate students working at present. We are running 18 courses in the trimester system and have started 16 courses in the recently introduced semester system. So this year, 4 MSc and 2 PhD students will be receiving their hard-earned degree during 59th convocation. The research work carried out by the students can broadly be categorized into two theme areas: enhancing the yield and abiotic stress tolerance in plants, nutrient profiling of food crops and their nutritional quality assessment. One MSc and two PhD students worked in the first theme area, while three MSc students carried out their thesis work in the second theme area in 4 different crops: chickpea, pigeon pea, rice and pearl millet. One of the PhD students, Mr. Chirag Maheshwari, worked under the guidance of Dr. Arna Tyagi to study the impact of Rubisco knockdown on photosynthesis and growth characteristics of rice plants. Here I would like to mention that Mr. Chirag got the opportunity to work at ERI Philippines under IRI ERI Student Sandwich Program sponsored by ERI, and major share of his research work was carried out at ERI only. As his mentor, Dr. William Paul Quick, is group leader of C4 Rice Group at ERI. The long-term goal of his study was to improve the rice yield through insertion of C4 photosynthetic pathway. And to achieve this goal, they aimed at first translocating Rubisco from the mesophyll cells to the bundleshell cells. They approached this aim by reducing endogenous Rubisco in mesophyll cells by downregulation of 2 Rubisco small subunit genes, RBCS2 and RBCS4, using artificial microRNA construct. They raised and analyzed the transgenic plants and compared the results with the wild type. The results of the biochemical and molecular analysis of the transgenic events are highlighted in this slide. For RBCS2 knockdown, they could get 40 PCR positive transgenic plants from 2 events in T3 generation, while 40 PCR positive plants for RBCS4 were selected from the T2 generation. The southern blot analysis revealed the presence of 2 and 4 antisense copies respectively in 2 RBCS2 knockdown events, while in case of RBCS4, 3 and 2 antisense copies were found in the 2 events respectively. Further, the transcript abundance and protein levels were also found to be significantly reduced in all the 4 events. The amino localization studies confirmed the reduction of the Rubisco protein preferentially in the mesophyll cells. Further, the extent of reduction correlated well with the number of antisense inserts. One more student, Mr. Nitin Kumar Garg, worked under the guidance of Dr. Arna Tyagi for his PhD thesis work. In this project, they explored the use of peclobutazole for the amelioration of water deficit stress in rice. The title of this thesis and the objective of the study are clearly mentioned in the slide. As I mentioned before, the major goal of this study was to improve the water deficit stress tolerance in rice. And since ABA has a great role to play in the water deficit stress tolerance, the student aimed to study the effect of peclobutazole application on the ABA metabolism. Their approach was to decipher various physiological, biochemical, and molecular alterations occurring in the plant metabolism during water deficit stress after peclobutazole application. The study was carried out using 3 rice genotypes: Nagina 22, which is drought tolerant, IR64, which is drought sensitive, and IR64. With DTY1.1 QTL, which is a major QTL for grain yield under drought stress. And this is again a drought tolerant as it is near isogenic line of the IR64. Mr. Nitin also studied the changes in the different physiological and biochemical parameters like relative water content, membrane stability index, chlorophyll stability index, ABA levels, and total antioxidant capacity. All these parameters were found to increase after peclobutazole application, while a decrease was observed in other parameters analyzed such as GA level, drought susceptibility index, and the global methylation. The decrease in the GA levels is expected as Paclobetrazole inhibits one of the enzymes of GA biosynthetic pathway, which may divert the intermediate towards ABA biosynthesis, as these two hormones are synthesized by the same biosynthetic pathway in the cell. The student also studied the expression of the genes involved in the ABA biosynthesis and degradation after paclobutazole application. The expression of ABA biosynthesis genes like NCED and the zeaxanthin epoxidase was increased, while the expression of the genes involved in the ABA catabolism like say ABA hydroxylase was reduced after the paclobutazole application, which resulted in the net accumulation of the ABA. The expression of the genes involved in the GA biosynthesis and chlorophyll biosynthesis were also studied under mild and severe water stress conditions, and it was found to be enhanced. Another student, Ms. Shreya Mandal, worked under the guidance of Dr. Ranjit Ranjan Kumar and studied the use of bioelicitors for mitigation of terminal heat stress and for enhancing the nutrient density. The objective of the study are highlighted here. This was the bioformulation developed by them for treatment purposes, which comprises neem extract, moringa extract, and the culture of thermostable Bacillus myeloliquefaciens. The application of the formulation was done at the germination and pre-enthesis stage. The student also carried out the root architecture studies, and the results of which clearly showed the positive influence of bioelicitor treatment. They also studied other characteristics of root structure, which define not only its growth and conductivity, but also the capacity to take the nutrients. And here again, positive effect of the bioelicitor treatment can be clearly seen. The cultivar HD2985 performed better as compared to the other genotypes. The student also studied the effect of bioelicitor treatment on the total antioxidant potential of wheat under heat stress in different tissues. HD2967 cultivar performed better in this regard, and maximum antioxidant potential was observed in root tissues. The bioelicitor treatment also led to the improvement in the starch content of wheat under heat stress conditions. Also, reduction in the amylase activity was observed after bioelicitor treatment. So these are the conclusion of the study. The bioelicitor treatment improves the overall root morphology, enhances the total antioxidant capacity, and also improves the starch content of seed under heat stress. In the second theme area of nutrient profiling of food crops, three MSc students carried out their work. Ms. Dipanita, who presented her work for IRI Merit Medal contest held day before yesterday, worked under the guidance of Dr. Venuta and assessed the protein quality and digestibility in chickpea and pigeon pea along with their antioxidant potential. They also studied the effect of processing such as cooking and canning on protein digestibility and antioxidant potential. The goal of the study was to identify affordable quality protein sources to fight the menace of malnutrition. And to achieve this goal, they did nutritional composition analysis of chickpea and pigeon pea genotypes and also studied the effect of processing on nutrition quality. So total 34 genotypes were used in this study, 12 genotypes each of desi and kabuli chickpea and 10 pigeon pea genotypes. The amino acid score of desi and kabuli chickpea genotypes was calculated, which revealed that all the genotypes of chickpea are rich in all essential amino acids except lysine and threonine. They also determined the in vitro digestibility and PDK score, which was found to be better in desi chickpea genotypes. Also, degree of hydrolysis of protein was determined because it is a major determinant for the use in the various food industry. Chickpea proteins were found to have lower degree of hydrolysis. The student also analyzed the antioxidant potential of the chickpea and pigeon pea, which was found to be higher in pigeon pea than chickpea. Ms. Dipanita also studied the effect of cooking and canning on protein digestibility, but not much change was observed. Rather, PDCAS value was slightly enhanced after cooking, and also a good correlation was observed between the protein content and digestibility of chickpea, but this correlation was not observed in pigeon pea. The conclusion of the study are summarized here, which clearly pinpoint the fact that the chickpea and pigeon pea can be a very good alternative to egg and milk for protein, as they have balanced amino acid composition and thus they can provide 45 to 100% daily value of various essential amino acids. Another MSc student, Mr. Sohil Rahman, worked under the guidance of Dr. Veda Krishnan and attempted nutritional phenotypic of rice genotype for high quality starch and fiber, which is an utmost requirement for low glycemic potential. Also, they developed and validated two starch quality matrices and a regression model for glycemic potential and good eating and cooking quality. For the development of starch quality metrics, they analyzed 14 parameters of starch quality, which are primary and secondary indices for low glycemic potential and high eating and cooking quality. For the first time, they included microstructure of rice as one of the parameters in the scoring system because it has been found to impact the starch digestibility immensely. Two starch quality matrices were developed, one each for low glycemic potential and for good eating and cooking quality, with the help of the heat map and scatter plots, which were drawn to study the relationship between the different indices referred above. Further, they also developed a regression model based on the total starch content and apparent amylose content of rice cultivars and identified four promising genotypes for low glycemic potential. They did the functional validation of this model by studying starch hydrolyzation kinetics of four genotypes by simulating gut conditions in vitro, and Cimbalce basmati was found to have maximum slow digestible starch, resistant starch, and the nutraceutical starch. So in nutrition theme area, one more student, Mr. Manikanta, did his MSc thesis under the guidance of Dr. Archana Sajdev. They determined the protein quality and digestibility of different pearl millet genotypes and also studied the effect of hydrothermal treatment on the quality and digestibility of pearl millet protein. And here I would like to mention that hydrothermal treatment has earlier been developed in our department for extending the shelf life of pearl millet flour. A density matrix has been developed in our department to classify pearl millet genotypes into low, medium, and high rancid groups. 15 genotypes belonging to different rancid groups were selected for this study and their protein content and amino acid composition analyzed, which revealed a balanced amino acid score and an encouraging percent daily value of essential amino acids. These results showed that 49.3 to 169.5% of DV of essential amino acid can be met by consumption of 100 grams of pearl millet. The PDCAS percentage for pearl millet protein ranged from the 39.4% to 60.18%. So they also studied the effect of hydrothermal treatment on PDCAS value, but no significant variation was observed in control and treated sample. So overall, I would like to say that pearl millet is not only a good source of calories for humans, but also it is a good source of nutritious and easily digestible protein whose quality is not affected by the hydrothermal treatment. So these are the some of the awards won by our faculty members during 2020. To name a few, Punjab Rao Deshmukh Outstanding Women Scientist Award was conferred to Dr. Archana Sajdev, and Fulbright Postdoctoral Fellowship was awarded to Dr. Veda Krishnan. So these are the awards won by the students. NHP CAST Fellowship was awarded to Mr. Sandeep Kumar and Ms. Shreya Mandal for availing the international training. Overall, 27 research papers were published by students and faculty members during 2020, and 50% of those papers were published in journals having NAS rating more than 8. We also organized two training programs under the aegis of NHP CAST and DPT respectively. In the end, I offer my sincere thanks and acknowledgements to all those who helped and contributed in the academic progress of the division during 2020, and I thank one and all for the patient listening. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Dahuja. Thank you so much. The next presentation is by Professor Debasis Patnaik from Molecular Biology and Biotechnology.
Honorable Chairman of the session, Director IARI, Dean PG School, Convener of the session, all the dignitaries, faculties, and students, let me present significant research achievements of the Division of Molecular Biology and Biotechnology. Total 24 MBB courses were offered in different trimesters. After adoption of semester system, these courses were revised as per BSMA guidelines, and 22 courses have been offered in two semesters by 27 faculty members. Total 55 students, 22 MSc and 33 PhD students are pursuing their study in the division at present. This year, 14 students, 8 MSc and 6 PhD students are receiving degree. Research works are categorized into three broad theme areas: abiotic stress management, biotic stress management, and basic study. Research works of 4 MSc and 3 PhD degree recipients were aimed to improve abiotic stress tolerance of crops. Mr. Megabath Robi Nayak characterized nitrate reactase homeologs in wheat under the guidance of Dr. P.K. Mandal. In silico analysis showed that 9 nitrireactive genes are present in bread wheat in 3 homologous sets, of which NR6-1ABD was the most responsive under nitrogen stress in 2 contrasting genotypes, HD2967 and Chotilarma. Sequence analysis revealed that allelic variation is much more than genotypic difference, and B homologs has more SNPs than A and D. Expression analysis showed that D homolog was the most responsive in both the genotypes under chronic nitrogen stress. During transient nitrogen stress, all the 3 homologs showed gradual and significant downregulation in HD2967. However, the changes were insignificant in Chotilarma. Mr. Samardev analyzed metabolite allantoin in different rice genotypes under the guidance of Dr. Tapan Mandal. Significantly high level of allantoin accumulation was observed in salt tolerant rice genotypes after 3 days of salinity stress. However, no significant difference in allantoin accumulation was observed in salt sensitive genotypes during salt stress. In the segregating mapping population, allantoin accumulation was more in tolerant bulbs than in sensitive bulbs during salt stress. Ms. Priyanka Kumari studied modulation in wheat root system architecture in the presence of wheat Phalaris minor and cloning and characterization of a wheat nitrate transceptor gene under the guidance of Dr. Subodh Kumar Sinha. Wheat Phalaris minor modulated wheat root architecture by changing its length as well as number under nitrogen starvation and soot biomass translocation to root under nitrogen starvation and weed root competition condition. Analysis of upstream sequence of the most responsive wheat nitrate transceptor gene NPF6.4A revealed variation in number of cis regulatory elements in all the 3 homologs. Ms. Tamilarasi studied physiobiochemical and molecular mechanisms of salt tolerance in wheat variety Kharchia 65 under the guidance of Dr. Kanika. Overall seedling growth after 14 days of salt stress was better in salt tolerant variety Kharchia 65 than that of salt sensitive variety HD2851. Similarly, salinity induced decline in root surface area, total root length and root volume was lower in Kharchia 65 compared to HD2851. Under salt stress, Kharchia 65 maintained higher relative water content than that of HD2851. Decline in the total dry weight of Kharchia 65 was less compared to HD2851 under salt stress. Increase in sodium level was higher in roots of Kharchia 65, whereas it was higher in leaves of HD2851 during salt stress. 5- to 6-fold upregulation in expression of vacuolar pyrophosphatase gene was observed in Kharchia 65, whereas fold upregulation of the gene was less in HD2851. Mr. Manoj did SNP genotyping and identified QTLs governing anaerobic germination under the guidance of Professor N.K. Singh. A mapping population was developed by crossing IR64 and tolerant wild rice accession NKSWR397. The mapping population was genotyped using 50K SNP chip and a genetic map was generated with 973 polymorphic SNP markers. 9 QTLs were mapped for anaerobic coleoptile elongation, out of which 2 QTLs were stable across 2 seasons. 5 QTLs were mapped for anaerobic survival percentage. Mr. Kishore Panjade employed transcriptome profiling approach to identify and characterize heat stress responsive genes from Ziziphus numularia under the guidance of Dr. Jasdeep Padaria. Transcriptome sequencing was carried out from leaf tissues of genotypes Jaisalmer and Godhra after 2 hours of heat stress and 42 degrees centigrade. About 82,000 unigenes were identified. based on fold change and annotation in transcriptome data, 10 differentially expressed genes associated with heat stress response were analyzed using quantitative real-time PCR. Highest level of expression was recorded in the chaperone gene CLPB1 in response to heat stress. The gene was cloned, sequenced, and analyzed in silico. The gene was further cloned onto plant transformation vector and introduced into tobacco employing agrobacteria-mediated genetic transformation. Transgene integration was confirmed by PCR analysis and southern hybridization. Variation in the level of expression of the introduced gene was observed in different transgenic lines. Total chlorophyll content, membrane stability index, and relative water content were higher in T1 tobacco transgenic seedlings compared to wild-type plants under heat stress. Ms. Sarita Kumari did genotyping of a backcross population with high-density gene-specific SNP chip to identify QTLs for salinity tolerance at both settling and reproductive stages under the guidance of Professor N.K. Singh. Backcross population developed by crossing IR64 with a salt-tolerant wild rice accession NKSWR173 was genotyped with 50K SNP chip and phenotyped at both the settling and reproductive stages. 7 QTLs for high salinity tolerance at the settling stage and 6 QTLs for moderate salinity tolerance at the reproductive stage were identified. Red box QTLs are contributed by the salt-tolerant wild rice accessor. Chromosomal locations of the QTLs contributed by the wild rice accessions and IR64 are shown in red and blue respectively. The lines highly salt-tolerant at both the stages were backcrossed to the recurrent parent IR64 to generate BC2F1 seeds for the development of advanced integrated lines. Research studies of 2 MSc and 2 PhD degree recipients were aimed to improve plant biotic stress tolerance. Ms. Somia Gupta screened Bacillus thuringiensis isolates collected from different locations in India for the presence of CRY52 type insecticidal gene under the guidance of Dr. Sarabjit Kaur. She screened 60 native BT isolates using specially designed primer sets for amplification of a short fragment of the gene. 34 isolates were found harboring the gene. Full-length gene was PCR amplified using nested primer, cloned and analyzed by restriction digestion. Ms. Asika Devbarma screened BT isolates for the presence of another insecticidal gene, CRY1I type, under the guidance of Dr. Sarabjit Kaur. Two genes, CRY1I119 and CRY1I934, were PCR amplified from BT isolates using different sets of primers, cloned and sequenced. Phylogenetic neighborhood analysis showed that the two genes are grouped in two different clusters. Insecticidal efficacy of the overexpressed proteins were analyzed through in vitro bioassay on artificial diet. CRY1I119 or CRY1IB7 was found to be more potent than the other CRY protein. Mr. Lianthan Zhuva did comparative transcriptome analysis of the Indian mustard during successful and unsuccessful mustard aphid interaction under the guidance of Dr. Ramcharan Bhattacharya. Transcriptome analysis of mustard leaves infested with host and non-host aphids was sequenced using Illumina platform to compare and identify the set of transcripts involved in successful and unsuccessful host interaction by the two aphid species. Comparative assessment of gene expression showed differential regulation of defense and metabolism related genes, suggesting more transcriptional reprogramming of the host by the successful insect pest. Ms. Mamta Gupta cloned and characterized Bacillus thuringiensis vegetative insecticidal protein genes under the guidance of Dr. Sarabjit Kaur. Full-length genes were cloned after screening 155 native BT isolates. sequence analysis of 12 genes revealed the identity with VIP3A-type genes. Multiple sequence alignment of the amino acid sequence revealed new substitutions in the cloned genes except in one. 6 overexpressed VIP3A-type proteins demonstrated growth retardation and motility of Helicobarba armiger LRV. LC50 value of the 6 VIP3A-type proteins ranged from 0.91 to 10.59 microgram per gram, indicating overlapping fiducial limits. 2 MSc students and 1 PhD student carried out basic research work. Mr. Ankan Chakraborty did functional validation of promoter of wheat PM19 gene under the guidance of Dr. Monica Dalal. Binary vector cassettes for tobacco transformation were constructed by putting full-length gene and partial PM19 gene promoters before GAS gene. Putative tobacco transformants were analyzed by PCR and GAS histochemical assay, and 21 transgenic lines harboring PM19 full-length promoter and 27 transgenic lines harboring partial PM19 promoter were obtained. Spatiotemporal regulation analysis of T1 transgenic seedlings demonstrated that promoter fragments drive high level of GAS expression in leaves but low level in roots under normal growth conditions. Mr. Jeet Roy carried out phenotypic and molecular genetic studies of EMS-induced mutants of Nagina 22 with varying panicle architecture under the guidance of Dr. Amita Mitra. The selected mutants were grown at 2 different locations for phenotypic analysis. Molecular analysis was carried out employing whole genome sequencing and QTL-seq approach. Mutant MGO10 had the highest values for TLR number but lowest values for all other traits. MG502 and MG469 had the least number of TLRs and panicles but had the highest values for all other traits including panicle dry weight. Whole genome resequencing data were generated for each of the mutants. Out of the 64 candidate genes analyzed, 34 genes showed amino acid substitutions across the 7 mutants. Mutants were erect and longer phenotype corresponded with higher number of non-synonymous changes in the gene ideal plan architecture 1. Mutant with the higher green number had a larger number of non-synonymous substitutions in green incomplete filling 1 gene that determines grain number. CAPS markers were designed for these 2 candidate genes for further validation. Mr. Pawan Mankar identified and characterized protease inhibitor genes under the guidance of Dr. Rekha Kansal. He identified 35 protease inhibitor family genes by searching PGNP genome. 3-dimensional structures built by homology modeling were used for molecular docking, and 9 genes were shortlisted. The selected protease inhibitor proteins were overexpressed using bacterial expression system to determine their insecticidal property. In vitro bioassay on artificial diet against Hemipteran and Lepidopteran insects pest demonstrated acute toxicity of some of the protease inhibitors, causing up to 72% mortality of both the types of insects. Total 14 publications in different NAS rating journals have so far been published by the degree recipient students. MBB faculties published 64 research papers in the year 2019. I am happy to inform you that majority of degree recipient students are well placed. 2 MSc degree recipients are pursuing PhD at IRI and 3 others at different universities and institutes including Delhi IIT. 1 MSc degree recipient got appointment as Bark scientist. 3 PhD degree recipients got different government jobs and 1 is working as SRF. Dr. Sikha Dixit got IRI merit medal in the 58th convocation. This is the list of honors and awards received by MBB faculties. Dr. Sanjay Singh received team award. Dr. Nimi received best oral presentation award. Dr. Sandhya got Best Oral Presentation and Outstanding Biotechnologist Award. Dr. T.K. Mondal was nominated as members of different committees. Dr. Subodh Sinha received Best Oral Presentation Award. Dr. Jasdeep Padaria was nominated as member of IBSC of Indian Institute of Wheat and Barley Research. Dr. Pranam Mondal was elected as editorial board member of two different journals. Farewell to last year degree recipients was the last activity MBBS students performed in person. Since then, all the activities are conducted online. With humility, I thank all for your guidance, support, and contribution. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Patnaik. Now, the third presentation, that is the last presentation of this session, is on plant physiology by Professor Madan Pal Singh.
Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Madan Pal, presenting the significant research achievements of the PG students from the discipline of plant physiology. During the last year, the student work was represented into three thematic areas: plant nutrition, photosynthesis, and abiotic stolons. In the area of the plant nutrition, three MSc and two PhD students submitted their thesis. Samrat Das worked with Dr. Lakshmi on identification and characterization of the microRNAs associated with the nitrogen starvation response and the nitrogen absorption. These are the two objectives of the work. And he worked with, started the work with 41 feed genotypes, which are grown in the normal and the deficient nitrogen conditions. And then various physiological parameters were analyzed, and based on their response, eight contrasting feed genotypes were selected. This is the list of the contrasted genotypes. Then these contrasting genotypes were evaluated under the hydroponic conditions, and it was found that nitrogen deficiency significantly promoted the root growth, increased the anthocyanin content, and variably affected the oxygen content. Then the expression of the microRNAs was also done in the contrasted genotype. Three genotypes were selected for this study, and it was found that nearly 100 microRNAs are differentially regulated in response to nitrogen deficiency, and that the genes of them represent the four classes, mainly kinases, nitrogen metabolism, and other two, secondary metabolism and the transcription factors. The conclusion of this study is that the high nitrogen use efficient genotypes have the effective and coordinated signal transduction network involving the microRNAs targeting nitrogen metabolism and other two metabolism. Anti-Duck worked on high throughput phenotyping of rice genotypes for nitrogen use efficiency with Dr. Dandapani Raju, and these are the two objectives. And this is the first thesis from the plant physiology which has been submitted using complete the phenomics platform. This is the overview of the research work plan. He has taken 300 diverse genotypes grown under the normal and stress conditions. Phenotyping was done, then the data was analyzed, and the GWAS was collected. This is the list of the all 300 genotypes, which represent the two subsets and classified into the five groups. And the PC analysis was done using the image derived data and analysis of phenome image data of 68 eye traits led to differentiate the genotypes without nitrogen at two stages, 68 and the 75 DAS. This is the data on the PCA. Then the multi-triate factor analysis of the data was done, and based on this analysis and genotype-by-genotype distances, five rice genotypes were identified as elite nitrogen use efficient donors, and one of them was contrasting recipient. Then GWAS was done for mapping the QTLs, candidate QTLs. And on the basis of this study, four major QTLs associated with nitrogen uptake efficiency and nitrogen utilization efficiency were identified. This is a summary of the work, and the conclusion of the study is that phenomic platform is the best approach for phenotyping the large set of genotypes of rice for nitrogen use efficiency and mapping of the QTLs and crop improvement program. Ravi Tej worked on interactive effects of the elevated CO2 and phosphorus nutrition on rice grain quality with Dr. Ranu Pandey. These are the two objectives of his work. Then he conducted two experiments, one in the pot culture, another in the hydroponics, taken three rice varieties grown at the two levels of the phosphorus and the two levels of the CO2. And this is the data on the grain elemental profile and cooking quality in general. There was a variable response in the change in the nutrients, particularly the important changes were the reduction in nitrogen level. On the other hand, MLOs and the gel consistency related to the cooking quality were also higher in the plants grown with elevated CO2, while there was no effect on the P nutrition. They also analyzed the sugar profile, and it was found that most of the carbohydrates showed nearly threefold increase in rise under elevated CO2, while the pea application had no effect. Similarly, the chalkiness increase and crude proteins in the grains reduced under the CO2. Then the effect of pea stress on root oxidation was also studied, and it was found that APA's activity and total organic acids increased, and no significant changes were observed in other biochemicals in the soil. The study concluded that eCO2 may affect the grain nutrient quality in terms of altered mineral content, reduction in the total nitrogen proteins, higher carbohydrate, but pea nutrition has no influence. Similar changes may occur in the cooking. Surinder worked with Dr. Anup Pandey on identification and characterization of the donors in mung bean for tolerance to low phosphorus and drought stress. And the work was divided into three objectives. He taken the 100 mung genotypes, which were grown under the two levels of the phosphorus as well as the drought stress conditions, and the same genotypes were among them. PC analysis was done, and from the 100 genotype, 10 genotypes contrasting were selected, and they were grown in the soil culture conditions with the P and drought stress level, and the PC analysis, the relative values shows that there is variability, significant variability among the response of the genotype. Then he also conducted the physiochemical basis of the phosphorus deficiency. It was found that the total organic acids increased under the low P stress. The activity of the antioxidant enzymes also were higher in the tolerant genotypes, and also the pollen viability and stigma susceptibility were significantly reduced under the drought conditions, but no effect of the P was there. Then he also studied the expression of the candidate genes, and it was found that some of the relative expression of the phosphorus stress inducible genes as well as drought stress inducible genes was higher in tolerant type compared to the sensitive. Then the study concluded that the identified donors as well as physiological traits can be recommended for developing the phosphorus use efficient genotypes to enhance the grain yield under the low P and the drought stress conditions. Somia worked on the genetic variation for improved phosphorus use efficiency and associated physiological traits in wheat. There were the two objectives of the study. She has taken the 104 genotypes of the wheat and triticales, and they were grown under the normal and the low P conditions in the field as well as in the hydroponics, and based on the relative biomass and the grain weight, the PCA analysis was done, and the clustering of the genotype was done into the four groups: efficient, moderately efficient, inefficient, moderately inefficient. And then this is the genotypes of the efficient collector showed no significant change in the root oxidation of organic acids, but the phosphatase activity was more than doubled under the low P condition. This is the list of the genotypes which were clustered. And then she also analyzed the genetic variation using the 35 KS and PRR genotypic data. And it was found by from the population structure and diversity analysis revealed three subpopulations which were named as C1, C2 and C3. And the study concluded that this information will be helpful in understanding the complexity of the pea efficiency in wheat and provide opportunities for developing bread wheat varieties under low pea environment. In the theme 2 on the photosynthesis, one Alok worked on response of rice transgenic lines or expressing the SVPAs and refractivase genes under the elevated and CO2 and high temperature environment. He has taken the 6 transgenic lines, 3 expressing the SVPA genes and 3 overexpressing the refractivase and the 1 wild type. They were grown in the controlled environment and exposed to the ambient CO2, elevated CO2, controlled temperature and high temperature. The data on the rate of photosynthesis and total endotoxin capacity was enhanced in the transgenic lines under the elevated CO2 and high temperature stress, and the level of the stomal conduction increased. We showed that the high temperature induced the change in the cooling capacity of this overexpressed transgenic lines. The transgenic lines also showed the better pollen viability and lower tissue temperature under high temperature stress. And the study concludes that the overexpression of the pseudohaptulose bisphosphatase and rubus-activase enzymes may improve the high temperature tolerance and the photosynthetic efficiency in rice. Madhurima worked with Dr. Vishnathan, and her work was on development of carbon-efficient rice by engineering the nocturnal fixation of respiratory CO2. These are the three objectives of the work. She started with real-time expression of the 4 of the genes of the Arabidopsis during the different day and night times. It was found that 2 of the genes were dark regulated, and then the promoter of those gene was cloned from the PS2. It was fused with the Gus reporter, and Gus assay was conducted, which showed that this cloned gene promoter is dark invisible. She also cloned the PEP carboxylation gene from the maize. It was mutated by converting the codon from serine 15 to aspartate, and then both recombinant protein from wild type and the mutated one was expressed in E. coli, then purified for kinetic assay. And kinetic study showed that the mutation reduced the KM value of the enzyme protein. Then the two binary reactors were constructed. One binary reactor was used for developing transgenic rice. It was confirmed by southern plot in the Arabidopsis, and it was found that transgenic event, two of them showed 30 to 40% lower nocturnal expression as compared to the wild type. The study provided a proof of concept for developing chem-like rice with nocturnal CO2 fixation for increasing tolerance towards high night temperature stress in future climate scenario. In the thematic area 3 on abiotic stress tolerance, one MSc and four PhD student completed their degree. This is the work of Dataram, worked with Dr. Pramod Kumar on photoprotective role of the acetic acid for heat tolerance wheat. He has taken the two objectives in the study. And 30 genotypes were grown under normal and late planting conditions for exposure to high temperature state at the flowering stage. And they analyzed various physiological parameters. And based on the acetic concentration, total chlorophyll content, and heat tolerance index, they identified two of the genotypes, a contrasting one. These both the genotypes were again grown in the field conditions, in the pot culture conditions under normal and late plant conditions, and then they were foliarly spread with 4 concentrations of the ascorbic acid at the booting stage before the exposure to high temperature. And it was found that some of the traits associated with the heat tolerance were actually induced with the application of ascorbic acid, like the heat tolerance index was enhanced and the susceptibility index was lowered. So the study concluded that foliar application of ascorbic acid can modulate the photoprotective activity and enhance the yield and heat tolerance in wheat by improving the photosynthetic and antioxidant capacity, growth and stagnant traits, and the restricting the ROS. Akshay Sakre worked with Dr. Vishwanathan, and his work was on physiological and molecular analysis of the root system architecture under osmotic stress conditions in rice, and these are the 3 objectives of this study. He started his work with 240 rice genotype, which were grown under the hydroponic conditions and exposed to the osmotic stress. And it was found that among 240 genotypes, 9 of them showed significant increase in the root, total root length as well as surface area under the osmotic stress, and they can be basically used as a donor for the root study. And the QTL identification was done by using the DIVAS approach. He genotyped the rice genotypes with 50K SNP chip, and DIVAS study was conducted, and they found that the 36 QTLs explaining the 20% variability were basically reported. And then the meta-analysis of the QTLs was done using the 576 QTLs already reported, and it was found that the out of 36 QTL mapped in this study, 26 are already reported, but the 10 of them were the novel. And this is the conclusion: these 10 QTLs can be related to the various root traits, can be used as donor for the dissection of the molecular mechanism of the root traits and genetic improvement in the rice. Omotayo worked with Dr. Ajay Roda, and his work was on mechanisms and the regulation of thermomember in wheat. The study was divided into 2 objectives. Initially, he has taken the 6 wheat genotypes, and they were exposed them to the 40 degree Celsius temperature for hours per day. And then he observed that one of the genotypes, C306, maintained relatively higher photosynthetic rate, TAC, as well as lower oxidative stress, and compared to then in the yield ranking also this variety performed very well. He also analyzed the expression of the 5 thermomembrane related genes, and based on the expression of these genes as well as the physiological traits, C306 and PPW343 were actually identified as tolerant sensitive type to high temperatures. In another experiment, effect of salicylic acid and heat priming was studied on both the contrasting genotype, seedling and genetic stage. So at the seedling stage, the genotypes were exposed to the very high temperature for a short duration of time, and then he analyzed the various parameters as to the heat tolerance, and it was observed that heat priming treatment significantly increases the CTD at seedling stage in C306. Also, both the salicylic acid and heat priming showed the elevated expression of the thermomemory-related genes and reduced the level of the ROS. Similarly, he studied the same response at the vegetative stage, and he found that the both genotypes showed the similar induced expression of the genes, but among them C306 showed the higher physiological tolerance in terms of the photosynthesis, membrane stability, etc. And the study concluded that the application of salicylic acid and heat priming can induce the tolerance against the adverse effect of high temperature stress. Rajiv worked with Dr. Ajarora on staggering traits for yield stability in wheat under combined heat and drought stress. These are the two objectives of this study. He has selected the 10 reels of the wheat and grown them in the field conditions, exposed to drought, heat, stress from the anthesis onwards. And based on the parameters on chlorophyll content, leaf duration, and the yield stability, he has identified two contrasting reels as high stegin and low stegin. Molecular analysis of the contrasting stegin reels was conducted, and it was found that high stegin reel showed the upregulation of the genes involved in the biosynthesis of the chlorophyll pigments compared to the low stegin reels. Then also the high stegin reels showed the lower expression of the genes involved in the ABA and its in biosynthesis compared to the genes involved in the degradation, and vice versa was observed in the low stegin reels. Then they also measured the ethylene and ABA content. It was found that high stegin reels showed the significantly less ABA accumulation and the ethylene emission as compared to the low stegin reels. So the study concluded that the stegin traits in the wheat in rows delaying of the senescence through the reduced level of the abscisic acid and ethylene and enhanced cytokinin level. Pratik worked with Dr. Rakesh Pandey on investigating the role of the DUF1645 proteins in abiotic stress tolerance and gain in the rice. He has taken the three objectives in the study, and the GWAS was conducted, and in silico analysis were also done for in the DUF family genes. And what he observed, the GWAS led to identification of 15 putative DUF protein coding genes in Oryza sativa. Then he also conducted the phylogenetic study, and which suggested there was a huge diversity among the DUF protein in the plants. And expression analysis of the DUF family genes was done in the rice genotype during the grain development and abiotic stress response in contrasted genotype. What he observed that the DUF1645 genes are differentially regulated by the abiotic stress condition, which suggests the regulatory role of these proteins in the stress response. He concluded that the DUF proteins are basic in nature, with non-polar conjugated amino acids at the C-terminal end. They have a very few conjugated motifs except for the C-terminal, and which is the one of the essential characteristics of the DNA binding protein. Therefore, the DUF could be potentially a DNA binding protein. This is the publication, save an international publication with the impact factor of 2 to 4, and also the 8 national publication with rating of the NAS above 5. And I'm happy to announce that one of my student has our student has joined as assistant professor Nitin Sharma only 2 days back in the Himachal Vice Parbar University. Then the two of the students have the foreign deputations. One of them going visited Purdue University and another at the National Institute of Agriculture Board in Cambridge. Then the two students got the best of all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Madanpal. So we have completed all the three presentations. So now I would like to request our chairperson, Dr. T.R. Sharma, for his remarks and his comments on these presentations. Sir.
Very good afternoon to all. Dr. A.K. Singh, Honorable Director of IRI, Dr. Rashmi Agarwal, Dean PG School, Dr. Seema Jaggi, Coordinator, distinguished professors, scientists, students, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. A.K. Singh and the Dean for giving me opportunity to be here this afternoon, and I could listen to very exciting presentation after a gap of more than 4 years. You know, this convocation week of IRI is one of the most important events of the Institute, for which we all eagerly look for and try to attend all the presentations. At least I try to attend all the presentations during my more than 15 years stay at IRI, particularly professors' presentations and also gold medal presentations. I don't think such practice exists anywhere in any other university in the country. So I would like to congratulate the director and dean and the whole team. In spite of the COVID-19 situation, you could organize this convocation week, for which all students and staff, they eagerly wait and look for the presentations of students and the professors. We all know that this was a very unusual year, and we all were skeptical whether we should be able to complete the PhD degree of students or not, because of the situation which was prevailing throughout the world. But I think the credit goes to all the teachers who could help their students remotely, and also student too, who can could respond to the teacher's query and also complete their work. In spite of the fact that complete year was almost zero as far as physical activities are concerned, particularly in this typical biology-like experiment where one has to go to lab and to the field, it's very difficult to collect data. And it was reflected from the presentation also. First of all, I would like to congratulate Dr. Anil Dahuja, Dr. Patnaik, and Dr. Madan Pal for making excellent presentation. When first presentation started, then I was thinking whether it is recorded or it is a live presentation. But then I got a message from Dr. AK Singh that all these were recorded in advance, and then to save time, and today the presentation is made. That's a new innovation, Dr. AK Singh, you have done, and it has really saved a lot of time. Lot of time.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
By sharing slides, some people, they listen, some they don't listen, don't maintain time. We all Indian are like that. But in this presentation, the structure which I listened today, although there was no personal communication, that has not been because of the COVID-19 situation, but the format which you followed for pre-recording and seamlessly presenting all the work of so many students, 30 students, 18 MSc and 14 PhD student in just a matter of, I think, 48 minutes. That would have not been possible had we met physically in the BP Paul auditorium. So that has saved a lot of time. And I would like to say that in spite of all these difficulties which we faced during last 1 year, was a question of life and death, but still all the presentations, all three presentations were excellent. And professors, all these professors, they have made all the efforts to come to the expectations of the listeners, particularly the people like me who is listening to the professors after a gap of 4 years. And I must say that I'm really completely satisfied the way the presentations were made, the data was compiled, and theme-wise students' presentations was arranged. That's another good thing which I could see this time. Otherwise, each student, one slide, two slides, and then not making story complete also doesn't look nice. So this time, I think the thematic presentation under which all these presentations were arranged were really very interesting to listen to. I looked at very critically all the presentations. Maybe I would say that some of the figures and the quality of figures and diagrams shown here were of international standard, but others could not match to that. That also varies from student to student and also professor to professor. So we cannot equalize that. But I would say that the student, the first student or second who did work, some work at IRI, see his southern blot and other blots and compare the one which we did at IRI, at New Delhi. One can make out the difference easily. So we should try to learn that. That's the purpose of this postdoctorate fellowship, which has started by Indian Council of Agriculture Research, that people should learn the basic trick and tips of doing lab, tips of doing work, and then presenting it in best possible manners. I was really happy to see those southern blot and immunolocalization, which was done by that student. I forget the name, but Dr. Anil Dahuja made that presentation from biochemistry. So others should follow such students and try to learn from that. I don't know whether students are also linked today or not. Are these linked? Students are linked?
Yes, sir.
They are listening.
We have total 410 people.
410 are, I can see 410 participants. That's really good. And I would like to say to the student that master and PhD, these 6 years or 7 to 8 years program, depends, problem to problem, are golden periods of our life, and you want to learn such things later on in your life. So whatever you have learned, the way you conduct an experiment, the way you collect data, and the way you analyze that data and interpret that, it's very hard to find in those students, those who are lacking in doing all these exercises critically in their even life career as a scientist. That is reflected from them. So IRI is a platform. It's a platform, the institute, wherein probably we can learn world's best practices. If it is not available in one lab, one can go to the next lab and then learn that things. But last year was very unusual year, so probably I may not be able to comment on the type of work and the complete story which I used to look in a PhD student's work. A story of work which tells you automatically what the student wants to do and what is expected from him and what are the conclusions, what would be its implications, and the lead obtained, which can be used by next student in the lab. I think that culture, again, we have to maintain. We are back to labs now. I am quite hopeful that this year, again, the physical presence will be made by all the student in the lab, in laboratories, and let us try to revive your material, which many of us might have lost, which I'm really very sorry, because But during this COVID period, one or two times I visited your field with Dr. A.K. Singh, and I was really happy to see that many of the scientists, they were taking care of the experiments of their students. That's very, very important, and particularly the life science field in which we are working. If we lose some material, means we will lose 1 year, one full year. So that's the reason I am not going to comment on the quality of work, but overall it was very good. And given the circumstances, I think no one can do better than this. And also, more importantly, I would like to congratulate all the teachers that you have saved 1 year of your student. And 1 year means a lot to a student or to anybody in their academic career. So it's all because of your persistent help and counseling to the student that you could save this material, and also to the student who can remotely work from their places and could complete their thesis. And I was happy to see that in basic sciences, almost all students are settled down, and they are either working as for their postdoctoral fellowship or selected here and there for MSc for different degrees and other for different jobs. That's the tradition of IRI. So we are very lucky. I still feel as a part of IRI that we are very lucky that we get very good students from throughout the country, and they are really the cream, and we need not to do much efforts to train them. They are theoretically very, very sound. And if you give little bit guidance to them, they can do wonder, and which we can see from their placement record and from the publication record, which will appear after a few years. So that's what I'm not going to comment even on publication, because publication takes its own time. In 1 year, you can't publish in good journal. After completion of PhD thesis in some work left, and again, you have to work for a few months with the help of other students and then complete a story and then publish in a high impact journal. But let us not forget that we should publish in very, very high impact journal from IRI. Had I been speaking at some state agriculture university, I would have not expected this and not said this. But for IRI, forget about NAS rating. Always think of international standard and international impact factor. And that's where we have to show the path. I was thinking that what one should do in basic sciences and where we are heading for. And while going through the literature, very interesting type of studies which in basic biology people are doing in different labs throughout the globe. And I would like to mention one or two areas probably which would be of some help to my colleagues, scientists sitting here. Particularly the role of transporters in movement of micro and macro elements in different parts of plants. It's a very, very important area which is emerging as a top-notch area in case of plant biology. And if we talk about seed, those who are familiar with seed biology, and particularly the rice worker, and I think most of agriculture scientists, they know that in seed, how these micronutrients are partitioned in pericarp, in aleurone layer, in endosperm, in embryo. And it is all because of the presence or absence of different transporters which are active during these developmental stages of seed. So are we going to go deep into the science and try to study this type of interaction? Are we thinking to do interactome analysis or protein-protein interaction? Because once we think of cellular communication, cell-to-cell communication, it's all because of protein. And so how one can study this protein-protein interaction and interactome analysis, we have now tools and technologies available with us, which can be used for doing this type of study. But the most important part here is, number one, your biological material. Number two, your approach, which you are going to use this particular types of experiment. Number three, the interpretation of results. Even transcriptome profiling, which many scientists are doing or students are doing in different types of work, that doesn't lead to the pure basic science. They are stopping at one level, maybe identification of transcripts and then stopping there. What that transcript is really doing in a particular plant organ or plant part, okay, and with whom that transcript is interacting. Is it a family of transcripts or a single transcript? So all those things one has to study. And similarly, nitrogen or micronutrient uptake, assimilation, and partitioning. It's very, very important. Now it has become a very important area. And also how these plants, they behave under shade and light condition. We do have a program where we are working on shade avoidance, plants related to that, particularly rice. So what there again, we are only at the level of selecting genotypes, and that's true. So I'm not going to speak. I am looking at the watch and we are already getting late. So maybe at some different occasion when there is enough time, I will give some other suggestions to my colleagues working in basic sciences, because I mostly worked in basic sciences, but at the back of my mind, it was always there, its application. What would be the application after, say, 5 years, 10 years, or 20 years? So that's very, very important. Don't stop at X stage. You have to go to, say, up to Z, and then complete this whole story, and then give some to the something to the farming community. So with these words, I would like to stop here. Dr. A.K. Singh, we are already late. I think 10 minutes late, so sorry. And thank you very much for inviting me to be here this afternoon.
Thank you, Raksham. Thank you for excellent suggestion, particularly on the frontier areas where our research in basic sciences should move, including interactome, and then enlarging the pathways, understanding them at molecular, biochemical, and interactome level. I'm sure my colleagues will take care of this to assign the research problems in future in these specific areas. Thank you so much for sparing your valuable time. In fact, we delayed by half an hour, so apology for that. But the previous session continued for a little longer, and therefore we could not start at 3. Thank you very much for your time and excellent suggestion. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Now I would like to take leave because I have some other meeting.
Thank you, sir. Okay, thank you. On behalf of PG School and on behalf of all the IRE fraternity, sir. Thank you for the guidance and all good words.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
sir. Thanks. So, should we proceed to the next session? Just take a deep breath and then we will proceed. Once again, I welcome all of you. And this is the fifth and the last session of today's deliberations on the professor's presentation. So at the outset, I would like to inform you that our honorable director, Dr. K.V. Prasad, Directorate of Floriculture Research, Pune. He will be chairing this session on the School of Horticultural Sciences. Sir, Dr. K.V. Prasad, presently director, formerly he was the first professor of newly created division discipline, that is Floriculture and Landscape Architecture. So from there, he moved to Directorate of Floriculture to join as director in 2015. So we are very glad to welcome you, sir, on this occasion, on the third day of 59th Convocation Week program. And we have now the presentations to be presented by the professors of four different disciplines under School of Horticulture Sciences. And there are 31 theses work which is to be presented during this session. 21 are the MSc theses and 10 are the PhD theses. So, and Dr. Seema Jaggi will continue to be the convener of this session also. And now with these words of welcome, I would like to request Dr. A.K. Singh, Director IRI, to introduce the chairperson to the all the audience, all the invitees.
Thank you. It's all done in a way. And Dr. Prasad, as we all know very well, he did his graduation, post-graduation from Andhra Pradesh Agricultural University, PhD from IRI, and then he joined the institute, became professor, and did a lot of work. I remember a project that was given by the Protection of Plant Variety and Farmers' Rights for developing the protocol for dust characterization of flower species, intensive work on mutagenesis. And that creation of new variability through mutagenesis led to, winning of Dr. V.P. Pal Research Memorial Award to Dr. Prasad when he was at IRI. And then subsequently, of course, he moved to Directorate of Horticulture Research. And then he has, to his credit, number of varieties, particularly in chrysanthemum at IRI, 7 varieties and 6 varieties of roses developed. He's also a fellow of the Horticulture Society of India, Indian Society of Ornamental Horticulture, and a very active and energetic person, full of energy all the time, as you can see. We would like to extend a warm welcome to you, Dr. Prasad.
Thank you.
To chair this presentation on horticulture sciences.
Thank you, Dr. Sir. Thank you.
Dr. Seema.
So I would also like to welcome you all to this session in which the presentations of School of Horticulture Sciences disciplines will be made. Total 31 students. The first presentation is from the discipline of floriculture and landscape architecture, and this will be by Professor Kamar Pal Singh.
Respected chairman of the session, other dignitaries present here, Honorable Director IRI, Dean and Joint Director Education IRI, Head of Divisions, Professors and Students. I'm going to present significant educational achievement for the year 2020 for the discipline of Floriculture and Landscape Architecture. This is the faculty and student position at IRI and IHR Bangalore. And this is the list of contributing students who are going to receive their degree during this convocation. Coming to the achievement under theme 1, this work on rose was carried out by Ms. Aparna Veluru with the following objectives. And for experiment 1, for morphological characterization, she took 148 rose cultivars of hybrid tree and floribunda groups, and 59 traits as per the dust guidelines were selected for present study. This is the list of varieties taken for the study, and this is the list of dust traits which were selected for this study. These are some pictures of important dust traits which were taken for this study. This is hierarchical cluster analysis dendrogram of rose genotype developed based on data of the morphological traits using average linkage. Coming to the experiment 2 on molecular characterization, again 148 rose varieties were taken and 48 SSR markers were selected for the study. These are some gel pictures of PCR amplification of SSR primers. And another experiment on assessment of substrate of rose was also conducted. This is the detail of the experiment 3. And this is the picture of rose varieties grown under coconut plantation. Coming to the research findings of this study, as per hierarchical cluster analysis, 148 rose genotypes were categorized into 8 different clusters based on its maximum morphological similarities. Out of 48 SSR markers used, 30 were found to be polymorphic, and 148 rose genotypes were categorized in different groups such as wild species, modern cultivars of exotic origin, and Indian origin. The row genotypes Pusarun, Aswani, Damask Rose, and Arunima performed better under coconut plantation as intercrop. Another study was taken by Ms. Vaisali on marigold with the following objectives. And under experiment one, floret size of marigold was standardized to have the maximum calcium induction and regeneration in marigold. It study revealed that floret size 3 to 3.5 mm gave better result in this regard. And these are the pictures of calcium induction and regeneration from anthers. After regeneration, these micro shoots were elongated on DA3 supplemented media, and which were rooted on IBA supplemented media for further studies. And polarity level of the regenerant were confirmed through chromosomal and chloroplast counting to isolate the haploid plants. And this haploid regenerants were again this multiplied on large scale for giving the colchicine treatment for doubling of the chromosomes. And these are the pictures of colchicine treatment. And after giving this colchicine treatment, again they were subjected for this polarity analysis through chromosomal and chloroplast counting. Coming to the research finding of this study, for in vitro endogenesis from anthers, floret size of 3 to 3.5 mm gave best results. And for chromosome doubling of dihaploid shoots, in vitro colchicine treatment at the rate of 0.005% for 36 hours was found best in terms of percent survival and percent doubling of chromosomes. Coming to the next team on production technology, experiment on lilium was conducted by Mr. Karthik with the following objectives. And this is a detail of experiment giving the different levels of NK and GA3. And this is the experimental design used. And this is the planting material of cultivar Pavia, which was used in this experiment. This is the field view of the experiment, which was conducted under ShadeNet. And coming to the research findings of this study, among various treatment combinations, the plant treated with NPK at the rate of 550 ppm plus GA3 at the rate of 350 ppm performed better with regard to vegetative growth, flowering, and bulblet production. Another study was taken on chrysanthemum by Ms. Lavanya with the following objectives. And in experiment number one, on screening of chrysanthemum cultivars for leaf longevity, 24 varieties were taken and leaves were collected at different stages after harvest. And this is the total list of varieties taken for the study. And this is the field view of the experiment. And among the varieties tested for leaf longevity, the Starter Century gave the better result with regard to other varieties, followed by Pusa Guldasta, which was having the better leaf longevity, and leaf browning was observed later, and it also having the better wildlife. Another experiment was conducted on studies on molecular polymorphism for senescence related genes in chrysanthemum, for which also 24 varieties were taken. And the 12 primers were selected for this study. And these are the gel pictures of quantification of DNA of 24 genotypes and PCR amplicons for different genes. And coming to the research findings of the study, among the 24 cultivars studied, cultivars Tata Century took maximum days for leaf browning, resulting in maximum wildlife, followed by cultivar Guldasta. Out of 12 primers studied, 8 primers were which belongs to the chrysanthemum sunflower were amplified. There was no significant variation in all 24 genotypes for the selected senescence associated genes. This is the picture of some training program organized by the division during the last year. And this is the list of awards and honors received by the students and faculty members during the year 2020. And this is a list of placement of our students and number of research publications published during the year. This is a picture of our PG lab, which was renovated recently. And I acknowledge the help and support received from the director IRI New Delhi, all the joint directors, head and professors of IRI, faculty members, and students. I thank one and all for patience hearing.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Kabarpalji. The next presentation is from the fruit science discipline by Professor O.P. Awasthi.
respected guys, I welcome you to the significant educational achievements of the Division of Foods and Horticulture Technology for the year 2020. Just to start with a brief introduction, these are our mandates. And as a faculty, we are 21 in number. And the number of students enrolled in the discipline of food science are 42, 13 in MSc and 29 in PhD. The total number of the degree recipients in the current convocation are 9, of which 3 are from PhD and 6 are from MSc. The research work by the students was carried out in three broad areas, that is the genetic studies and molecular characterization, crop improvement and character association, and crop regulation. Now coming to the theme one, that is genetic studies and molecular characterization. In continuation to the earlier breeding work, earlier mutants developed during the earlier years, morphogenetic characterization of Kinook mutants was attempted by Mr. Sunil Kumar. And in this particular study, he studied the morphological and physiological variations in the induced mutants of Kinook and analyzed the yield and fruit quality parameters and also characterized the Kinook mutants using the molecular markers. And these are the material and methods. 5-year-old putative mutants generated from varying doses of gamma irradiation in EMS were selected for the study, and they were compared with the wild type. And the mutants were further investigated using the SSR marker. Now, some of the salient findings of his study are that he could identify the dwarf mutants, which had a reduced canopy volume and a higher footing density, that is the mutants G6 and G9 developed from 20 gray, and E10 and E11 from 0.2% EMS. And the most important trait which we were looking for, that is, he could identify low seeded mutant having an improved food quality, that is G6 and G9 20 gray. That is, the number of seeds were considerably reduced to 8 to 9 as compared to 30 to 35 seeds in the normal Kinook mandrake. Then he also attempted the molecular characterization, and here we can see what he could conclude is that mutants G6 and G9 were found most promising and can be multiplied and released as a low-seeded dwarf mutants after detailed evaluation and testing in the replicated and the MLT trial. And in a similar line of work, Mr. Kuldeep Singh, a PhD student, he attempted the characterization of sweet orange in cultivar Mosambi mutants. And he too also studied the morphological and physiological and biochemical alterations in the induced mutants and also attempted the molecular characterization. And the experiment was conducted under two sets, that is 1 and 2. And here the population was developed through different doses of gamma rays. And here the population were raised through different doses of colchicine treatment were used for the study. And the most significant finding of his study was that the gamma irradiation and colchicines both have the potential to generate much needed variation in cultivar Mosambi and can generate variants for future use in the breeding program. This was in the pre-bearing phase. That is why some solid recommendation have not come on. Only the morphological, physiological and biochemical parameters were attempted. The most important finding will be in the when the plants come into the bearing stage. Then Chaitra, she carried out the work on sex identification in papaya using physiological, biochemical, and molecular markers. She validated the Jing Lin molecular markers in sex identification and also identified the sex forms in papaya based on physiological, biochemical parameters at seedling stage. And these are the material and methods. That is, it's comprised of the 6 varieties, 3 from the dioecious group and 3 from the gynodioecious group. And the salient findings of her work is that out of the 10 selected SCAR markers, PKBT 5 and SDP showed 100% reliability in identification of male or hermaphrodite plants. And other male specific markers, PMSM2, showed high percentage of reliability in identification of male plants only. All the 3 markers can be commercially used for the sex identification in the early development stage, which is a problem otherwise in case of papaya. Then Hanmant, an MSc student again, He carried out the molecular studies of pulp color in guava. And his object, the objectives of his study was to characterize the pulp color of selected guava genotypes and the F1 progenies, and to characterize the molecular sequence in the candidate genes involved in lycopene synthesis among the guava genotypes contrasting for the pulp. And these are the details of his experimental material. The details of his experimental material, that is total 8 guava parents at 31 were used to phenotype characterization. And similarly in experiment 2, these are the details, that is 4 pairs of overlapping primers were designed for PSY gene in guava, and the PSR products were then sequenced. And based on the segregation observed in the F1s from different crosses, it was quite evident that wild pulp color is homozygous recessive in nature. This was what he was able to conclude, and the segregation indicated that both the pink pulped varieties, namely Lalit and Punjab pink, are heterozygous from the genes governing pulp color in guava. Then coming to theme 2, that is crop improvement and character association. In this broad objective, Lee Thi Khoi, a Vietnamese student, she screened the root stocks for drought tolerance and compatibility in sweet orange. And the objectives of her study was the selection of citrus rootstock hybrids, which has been developed, which has been bred here for drought tolerance, and then selection of desirable draft combination for IARI release sweet orange cultivars, that is Citrus sinensis. And these are the details of her material and methods. In fact, 7 rootstocks were used for the study, and you can see here that some of the are the rootstock, some of the are the having the tolerance to the both salinity, sodium and chloride rootstocks are there, an array of rootstocks are there which she has used for the. And here these, here you can see the photographs, the different varieties responding to the drought tolerance, and particularly the root morphological character, it was completely changed. That is, this is the root system of the Sorsarkar throughout the drought course. You see, still no effect is there on the rootstock. This has bound to be extremely very drought hardy rootstock. And the salient findings of our study is that Sorsarkar, yes, and RLC5 are drought tolerant genotypes. Among hybrids H13, H20, H24, H11, 12, 27, 31 proved to be highly drought tolerant among the hybrids. Then Yamamikan had the relative restriction of growth, while the RLC6 and Jatti Khatti rootstock enhanced the tree vigor. In fact, this was a very big experiment, and some very good interesting results have been obtained on the drought tolerance of the mechanism of the rootstock. Then Lalit Singh Sisodia, again, he is an MSc student, and he attempted the morphogenetic characterization of first generation Kolchi plots in Kinu mandrake, that is the mutants which were developed through Kolchi sins. And then when he attempted it when the plants were three years age, and then he characterized the first generation Kolchi plots of Kinu mandrake and sweet orange, that is Mosambi, using morphophysiological traits, and characterized the selected Kolchi plots using the molecular markers. And these are the details of his material methods. Yes, 4 years old colchicin treated with different concentration, and then they were compared with the wild type. And then Kinnu also, it was in the same way, it was treated with colchicin, and the total number of plants were total 75, that is 43 and 22 and 5 each from the Kinnu and Mosambi, that is the wild. The salient findings of his study, the most significant was that the significant alterations in leaf characteristic, leaf scroll fiery, stomatal aberrations, and molecular characterization flow cytometry suggests that the Kolchi ploids are primarily indicative of putative tetraploids, and this can be a very important source in the breeding program for the developing the triploid cultivars. Mr. Vishal Mahetre, he evaluated the new generation growth regulators for quality grape productions, and these are the details of his experiment. The experiment was conducted on 2 cultivars, that is B2 seedless and Flame seedless, and he also attempted the workflow RNA sequence analysis. And from the salient finding of his work led to the conclusion that the treatment Cetaphon, that is 400 ppm and AB400 ppm, were found suitable for enhancing several berry biochemical parameters. And the most important finding of his study was that the RNA sequence analysis revealed that the few differentially expressed gene controlling the berry cultivar of cultivar flame seedless, among which DGs, namely UFGT and GST, were highly upregulated and hence identified to play a major role in anthocyanin biosynthesis. Then Channa, again, she's an MSc student. She characterized the guava hybrids for fruit quality traits and storage behavior. And these were the objective of his study. And you can see the variation, tremendous variability is there. And 15 guava hybrids of guava were studied. And the salient findings of her study led to the conclusion. Of course, there are several, many of them, but the most important had been that the guava hybrid 2017-2C had the minimum number of seeds, which is the most important trait which the student was looking for, then per fruit with a lower seed weight and minimum physiological layer loss in weight and maximum pulp is to seed is to weight ratio. And it also had the maximum total phenolic content and total soluble proteins. Besides this, there were some other interesting observations also. And then under theme three, that is crop regulation, one student, Mr. Om Prakash Meena, he was an in-service candidate from ICR IRI Regional Station Pune. He studied the effect of organic nutrient sources and microbial consortium on Kurukan seedlings and bearing Amrapali mango. And these were the objective of his studies, that is the effect of potting, organic potting mixtures and microbial consortium, and to find out the effect of organic nutrient sources and microbial consortium on annual tree growth, that is the morphological and physiological parameters. And these are the details of his experiment. The experiment was conducted in two parts, one and two. And then these are the salient findings. And the important finding was that the removal of seed coat of Kurukan mango seeds raised on treatment comprising of vermicompost plus microbial consortium was found to have a pronounced effect on the seedling germination, that is the growth parameters. And the treatment of vermicompost plus microbial consortium also resulted in improved plant growth and the other morphological and the physiological characters. And the higher net return per hectare Amrapali mango was obtained when grafted on the Kurukan root stocks. And these are some of the awards and honors received by the faculty members, quite a good in number. Almost six or seven are there. Dr. R.M. Sharma, Kanaiya Singh, Manish, Dr. Patel, and then also divisional award. First prize in Sambhagya Stariya in Hindi Pratyogita, Dr. Goswami, then Dr. Chaulesh Kumar, young scientist. Then awards and honors were also confirmed by the students. And Sridhar Ramchandra, he attended an international training in the area of food biotechnology at Wisconsin, USA. And Mr. Vishal Mahatre also, he got the best poster award in international e-conference that was organized by the University of Horticulture Sciences, Bagalkot. And then as so far as the employment is concerned, it has not been very encouraging because there are no posts from the ASRB for the last four to five years. And only one student, Mr. Kuldeep Singh, he was appointed as a subject matter specialist at Panchkula in Haryana during the year 2020, that is last June only. And these are the trainings conducted. One training was conducted on the non-conventional approaches for genetic improvement of perennial horticulture crops with 24 participants. And some of our students also attended the training, like Triva, Thevyani, Rina. They attended the genomics for improvement of horticulture crops under NAHEP. Similarly, Thivayani and Bhupendra Sagore, they attended the life skills and personality development by ICR under the NAHEP. Both the programs of the were attended under by the students under the NAHEP, funded by the NAHEP CAST. And lastly, I thank you one and all for your very patient hearing, and thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Awasthi. We now have the presentation from post-harvest technology by Dr. Sunil Kumar Jha.
Respected chair of the session, honorable director, dean, convener of the session, dignitaries in the audience, and my dear students, good evening to all. It's a privilege to make this presentation on students' achievement. This year, 6 students will receive degrees in post-harvest technology. Out of 6 students, 4 got employment and 2 joined PhD at IARI. As we all know, aged rice commands a premium commercial value. A quick and non-destructive method of evaluation of age of rice can help prevent fraudulent trade practices. Therefore, the study entitled Non-Destructive Evaluation of Aging of Basmati Rice Using Hyperspectral Remote Sensing was carried out by Mr. Rajvardhan Kiran Patil under the guidance of Dr. Abhijit Kar. 5 rice varieties were undertaken in the study. Rice was aged at 42 degrees centigrade and 42% relative humidity for 30 days, and spectral signatures and physicochemical characteristics were evaluated at 2-day interval. Overall results suggested that spectral reflectance can effectively capture the changes in physicochemical characteristics during accelerated aging of rice. The variabilities in the physicochemical parameters and aging could be defined within 600 to 1350 nanometer. Dehydration is well-established method for processing and preservation of food. Ganpati Rathor, under the guidance of Dr. V.R. Sagar, conducted a study on dehydration of capsicum. In the study, Ganpati used 3 colored capsicum varieties, including red, green, and yellow. Results revealed Orovele variety as most suited for dehydration. Pre-treatment with calcium chloride 0.2%, sodium chloride 3%, and sodium benzoate 0.2% was found good. Microwave drying was found better in terms of improving quality of slices and reducing time and retaining other chemical constituents and sensory score. Nectarine is an important stone fruit. The fruit has very short shelf life of 2 to 4 days at ambient condition. The storage life is reduced significantly by chilling injury. The main post-harvest diseases of nectarines are brown rot caused by Monilia practicola, rhizophus rot caused by Rhizophus stolonifer, and gray mold caused by Botrytis cinerea. 2 of our students worked on this fruit. Ms. Soumya, under the chairperson, Dr. R.R. Sharma, studied on post-harvest disease management and shelf-life extension of nectarine. She had 2 approaches for coating. First, she coated alone using mixed plant extract or edible coating, and then she used mixed coating. After the coating, the fruits were stored at supermarket conditions and at cold storage conditions. During the storage, fruits quality parameters were evaluated. The findings suggested that methanolic plant extracts exhibited higher antimicrobial activity against Rhizophus stolonifer and Penicillium expansum over aqueous extract. Mixed plant extracts had better antimicrobial efficacy than using plant extracts alone under both in vivo and in vitro conditions. Under in vivo condition, fruits treated with plant extracts before pathogen inoculation was found to be better compared to fruits treated after pathogen inoculation in inhibiting the growth of pathogens. Edible coatings and plant extracts were effective in extending the shelf life of nectarines by 16 days under supermarket condition and by 25 days under cold storage condition. Layer by layer coating of CMC, chitosan, and mixed plant extract could be used as substitute for chemical fungicide. Another student, Ms. Smriti Jairajan, under Dr. R.R. Sharma, studied the impact of melatonin and hydrocolloids on post-harvest life and quality of nectarine. C2 used Snow Queen variety in the study. Treatment details are shown in this slide. The fruits were stored at supermarket conditions and at cold storage condition. At regular intervals, quality of fruits were determined. It was concluded from the study that 1% CMC was effective in maintaining lower PLW and retaining other functional parameters. This coating enhanced shelf life of nectarine up to 12 days, which was comparatively higher compared to control sample where it was only 9 days. 0.1 millimolar concentration of melatonin was found good in alleviating chilling injury, which enhanced shelf life of fruits up to 28 days under cold and 16 days under supermarket conditions. The combination treatment of hydrocolloid and melatonin was more effective in controlling decay and extending shelf life of nectarine by 16 days. Mr. Pavan Kumar M, under the guidance of Dr. Ram Asre, studied the response of winter and rainy season guava fruits to post-harvest calcium treatments. He took four varieties in both rainy and winter seasons, treated the fruits with calcium lactate and calcium chloride, and during storage, the physical and physiological parameters of fruits were determined at regular intervals. The study revealed that post-harvest quality characters of stored guava fruits were significantly preserved by both the treatments. Calcium chloride at the rate of 3% concentration proved better, and it extended the shelf life of guava fruits up to 2 days during rainy and 3 days during winter season. Overall, Shweta variety was better in maintaining post-harvest traits throughout the storage period in both the seasons. Pallavi Neha, under the guidance of Dr. Divik Sudhakar Rao at IHR Bengaluru, studied on standardization of packaging and storage conditions for enhancing storage life of fresh and fresh-cut French bean. Study revealed that storage of beans at 6-7 degrees centigrade was found to be significantly effective and could be stored for 35 days with a shelf life of 4 days at ambient condition. In case of shrink wrapping, pre-treatment with sodium nitroprusside 0.5 millimolar worked well to maintain the physical and nutritional quality of pods, whereas in case of modified atmosphere packaging, pre-treatment with salicylic acid 2 millimolar was good. Our students, Ms. Smriti and Soumya, won poster presentation awards. Among faculty members, Dr. Abhijit, Dr. Shruti, and Dr. Alka received prestigious awards. And during the year, total 22 publications came out, with 17 having NAS rating more than 6. Our students also participated in Agri University Sports and All India Inter-Agricultural University Youth Festival. Our students also participated in various committees in Kisan Mela last year. Our students also availed study tour. Few glimpses are shown here. Finally, each one of you, special thanks to contributing students, their advisory committee members, director, dean, and members of PG School.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jha. So now the last presentation in this session is from Vegetable Science Discipline by Professor Tusar Kanti Behra.
Please. Chairman of the session, I am T.K. Behra from Vegetable Science, presenting the significant academic achievements for the year 2020 by the students. The mandate of this division is to conduct applied and strategic research on vegetable crops, imparts postgraduate education to disseminate information to recent advances in vegetable crops. The major thrust area is super development of super varieties and hybrids for higher productivity, quality, nutrition, value additions, and stress resistance in major vegetable crops. Number of faculty members are 28, and degree awardees to be given for PhD 4 and MSc 8. And the theme areas for the work they have done it: mapping tagging of genes and molecular breeding, genetic diversity, heterosis and seed production. This time 4 PhD students, they are to be getting the award for 2021, Saif Paul, Manish Kumar, Manpreet Kaur and Amarjit Kumar Rai. They are the PhD students and they did work in IIH Bangalore. MSc students are awarded to be degree 2021, are 8 students and they all admitted in IIR New Delhi, and they work in different crops and they join in the, most of them are joined in the PhD IRI. The first student, Saheb Pal, he is working on mapping of Fusarium wilt resistance in watermelon germplasm and accessing their potential as a rootstock. He worked to identify the resistance to Fusarium wilt in watermelon and bottle gourd germplasm Also, he used some intraspecific hybrids, that is Cucumeta maxima and Cucumeta mustard as a rootstock. He also studied the genetics and gene action for the resistance to Fusarium wilt. He also mapped Fusarium wilt resistance and influence of resistance rootstock, particularly in terms of yield and quality in the scion. So first he identified the resistance source from the different species of citrullus as well as the Cucumeta maxima and Cucumeta muscata and bottle gourd. And he isolated that some of the lines, those are resistance to particularly for these different rashes of Fusarium wilt. So the first he worked on the fawn rash 1, for which 99 highly resistant citrullus accession he observed, and in case of fawn rash 2, 8 highly resistant citrullus species of that accession has been observed. Now he did the mapping on the Fusarium wilt resistance employing the QTL seq also. So genomic regions identified through this QTL seq method in the chromosome 1 and chromosome 7. He also mapped the fine mapping with respect to the using the SSR and NDEL markers, and he got some of the tightly linked markers, particularly 3 markers, which is having showing the phenotypic variations ranging from 16.9% to 40.8%. He also validated the 3 markers with a different other cross respect to this Fusarium wilt resistance. And he studied the resistance accession also as a rootstock on the yield and quality of the watermelon through grafting. So when he grafted this watermelon with the bottle gourd and hybrid squash rootstocks, he found there is a deformity in the fruit sap. Whereas when he planted this citrullus, that is in watermelon, in the citrullus species, they found they are very good in quality and they are also resistant to the Fusarium wilt. And they have identified RS10 and RS11 in the Landers group and RS8 in citrullus mucospermus, which is resistant to this particular Fusarium wilt. And this RS1, one of them, is registered in the NBBGR for its large scale multiplication and addition to the farmers. Another student, Manish Kumar, he worked on the incorporations of the Phytophthora root rot resistance genes in cytoplasmic genic meristerile lines in Chile. He identified some of the markers. Also, he incorporated Phytophthora root resistance in the CGMS lines through this marker breeding. He identified the stable resistance source in the Phytophthora root resistance source from Chile, and he found that IHR3575, IHR3476, those are resistant and susceptible lines. And these lines are crossed, developed the F2 population, also BC1 and BC2 population, and they got some of the involvement of these genes, particularly major dominant gene along with few minor genes. They also validated some of the markers with respect to this link to the Phytophthora root rot resistance, and particularly HPMS1-62, HPMS E034, and HPMS E062, those are found to be resistant, which can be utilized for the breeding program. Genetic analysis, also another student done with this Manpreet Kaur with respect to this tomato leaf pearl New Guinea virus in ridge gourd. And he also identifies some of the resistance source within the ridge gourd to the tomato leaf pearl New Guinea virus. He studied the genetics and inheritance patterns also for tomato leaf pearl New Guinea virus, and also molecular markers, which is linked to this gene of interest. And here he also go for artificial screening, particularly white mediated inoculation. He did it, and he found some of the lines which are really resistant to this particular tomato leaf pearl New Guinea viruses. And he did the artificial screening methods by which Arca Prasan was found to be susceptible, whereas IHR selection 1 is found to be resistant to this particular disease. And he crossed the F1, F2 population, BC1 and BC2 population developed, and he found that tomato leaf pearl New Guinea virus resistance is controlled by single recessive gene. Also, he validated one of the markers, that is LARGIP63, in the F2 population, in the F2 type F3 population. She did the screening, and then he found that these markers also associated with the tomato leaf pearl New Guinea virus resistance. One student, that is Amarjit Kumar Rai, he worked on the combining the resistance of tomato leaf pearl New Guinea virus as well as bird necrosis virus in tomato. So identify also stable lines with respect to these two diseases, validate the molecular markers linked to this both the diseases, as well as he has seen the combined resistance to the leaf curl and bird necrosis disease in tomato, and then QTLs and other regions of the QTLs linked to this resistance for bird necrosis virus is also observed by him. So these are the stable sources of resistance, what he found ranging from 0 to 120% of that, or 100% of this susceptible, the disease severity will be there. And that case, a tomato leaf called Bangalore virus, here IHR2901 is found to be very, very resistant to this particular leaf called disease. And in case of stable source resistance in respect to the groundnut bud necrosis virus, also observed in some of the IHR lines. And at the crosses, then again in the F2 generation, she screened it with IHR2901 cross PKM1, which is a susceptible lines, and they got it some of the lines, some, and also he did the with respect to this particular disease. And he also analyzed the GBNB resistance in F2 lines and also find the TOI2 genes with respect to TG0302 markers, which is already linked to this particular tomato leaf colony virus. And he found some of the F2 population, both these genes, particularly GBNB resistant genes and TOI2 genes, are present in some of the lines. He got it GBNB resistance along with this TOI3 genes, and these he used for the further breeding program. He also identified the QTLs and genomic regions having QTLs linked to the GBNB resistance through QTLSEC approach. And also he also observed that some of the about 7 QTLs, which is found in the 3 chromosomes linked to this particular gene of interest. Also, he found some candidate genes located in the different genomic regions in the different chromosome, which harboring the QTLs for the bud necrosis virus. Now, another student, Pradeep Kumar, he studied this in vitro regeneration of cucumber, as well as comparative transcriptome analysis extending the shelf life of cucumber, which is very important, particularly for developing the inbreds. This haploid and double haploid is very much important, so he worked on that. Then he studied some of this stray green color, which is important to reduce the post losses of this particular crop. So he generated the gynogenesis way of developing the new plants having haploid, and under unfertilized ovaries at 1 day before anthesis were most suitable for direct regeneration. Also, he found that 4 days at 9 degrees Celsius combined with the 2 days treatment at 32 degrees Celsius and 2% sucrose concentration was found to be most suitable for effective genesis. Similarly, comparative genomic studies also done with respect to the stray green color in the DC48 and DC83, which is a normal fruit. And you can see after fruit 15 days, there is total ripening of the DC83, whereas DC48 are not ripened properly. So he did it, the crossing with this developing the F2 population. He screened some of the markers with respect to SSR markers and found 23 polymorphic SSR markers, which are identified with respect to polymorphic with respect to these two lines. And he did the comparative analysis study with respect to DC48 and DC83. At 2 developmental stages, 5 and 8 days. Then he also seen that the chlorophyll biosynthesis and degradation related differential expression genes with respect to the both these lines, and it was observed that these chlorophyll biosynthesis genes are also different in the way of expression with respect to the different condition or different genotypes. Similarly, he also carried out the qPCR analysis of the selected genes with respect to the ethylene biosynthesis pathway, and he found that in normal cucumber lines, there is a highly genes are expressed high compared to that of the genes in case of the stray green type of species. Then association mapping of heat stress related in cauliflower traits, also cardiac traits, has been found by Rakshita. Her objective to assess the phenotypic variations in cutting traits in Indian cauliflower in the two locations, one in the Barapani, that is in northern states, as well as in case of molecular diversity based on the cauliflower germplasm, and also find the genotyping sequencing. So he observed many of these lines, those are grown in the both the conditions, and here he found that the range of the different crop, the weight, particularly the marketable curd weight, is totally different. In Delhi condition, it was 208 to 1 kg, 400 grams. Whereas in Barapani, the same genotypes have a very less performance compared to the that signified that is the card trait or the crop trait is controlled definitely by the invited by the environment itself. And both the cases he found the GCV or genotypic variations has a major role to contribute to these particular crops. Then genetic diversity study also done it by using SSR markers, and if you see that the late group of cauliflowers are totally in the group, in different group compared to the other like early, mid early and mid late group, which also there will be mixing of these particular lines. Now coming to this GBS analysis for card related traits in cauliflower, they have isolated and have observed that QTL associated with the carding traits about three QTLs, particularly MCW1 is for weight, card weight, card diameter, that is in chromosome 5, and the net weight of the fruit, it is in chromosome 9. So these are the some of the QTLs which found to be associated with the carding traits. So student Susima Dhital, she is from Nepal. She worked on morphological and molecular characterizations of the tomato leaf called nudulic viruses, resistance in term case of tomato, and he assessed the different disease reactions in the different tomato lines, particularly for tomato leaf called viruses with respect to TY2 and TY3 genes, and morphological characterizations of the resistance genes for the yield and horticultural traits. And she grouped the five clusters and all the 30 tomato genotypes. It's interesting to note that in case of cluster 5, all the materials, there's four materials which are showing the resistance to the tomato leaf called nudulic viruses, and they also contain both resistant genes like TY2 and TY3, and maximal TSS was found in DT10 about 60 bricks, which may be suitable for processing, and DT11 and DT27, which exhibit a high pericarp thickness about 6 mm, and that showed that it is a better shelf life along with the suitable long distance transportation. Another student, Susmita, has worked on this studies on the structural and functional variations in the carotenoid pathway synthesis genes, and also yield parameters evaluations in the color capsicum. So she took about 12 genotypes having different colors, yellow, red, and because of this is green color, and he studied the structural variation, also the functional variation with respect to carotenoid pathway genes. And based on the performance of the genotypes in the two locations, one in Ranchi and in Delhi, Arca Magna was found to be most suitable, preferred variety with respect to different environmental condition, and it had also recorded highest yield per plant, fruit length, and minimum of 50% flowering. Then he studied some of the genes with respect to carotenoid biosynthesis pathway for the different pigment development, particularly lycopene, beta-carotene, and zeaxanthin. She also analyzed three approaches like PCR to know the polymorphism with respect to the band size, HRM analysis, Sanger's sequence to know the variations in the present within the sequence. And he also found that there is very limited variations, structural variations found in all the cases, particularly with respect to the different gene combination. And the size of the carotenoid biosynthesis genes might be conserved. They may be in the CA2 or this CA2 and JDS gene, which in the different genotypes. However, the point mutation may also occur observed in the different genotypes. There is very limited variations was found in this respect to structural variation. But if you see the functional variation, it can find that the genes that coding for the enzyme present in the upstream for the lycopene proteins like GGPS, PSY and JDS showed upregulation, while the genes coding for enzyme present in the downstream lycopene, that is LCY1 and LCYB, VDE and CCS showed very down regulations in respect to the different Pusa Jwala, Pusa Sadavar and Utkal yellow in their dry fruits. Similarly, some of the varieties like Arca Magna, Haldi Pada and Orabel, there is the expressions of CCS genes were found to be very high, and they translated into high capsaicin content in these particular varieties. The amount of carotenoid could be highly correlated with the expressions of the carotenoid biosynthesis pathway. Another student, that is Sulochana, she worked on different, particularly for the inheritance pattern of the fruit-bearing habit. Also, she mapped that particular gene and for QTL mapping for QTLs for governing the fruit habit in case of eggplant. So, she crossed one white-fruited, round-fruited type with a green-fruited type, and she also seen the solitary and cluster bearing habit of these in the F2 and BC1 and BC2 population. And she studied the Inheritance studies, revealed that the existence of recessive epistatic kind of gene interaction following the ratio of 9:3:1, where two genes control the bearing in case of eggplant. Mapping of fruit bearing habit in eggplant is also he studied in the QTL sec, and he found 6 QTLs. Those are identifying the 5 genomic regions are governing are controlled to this particular trait of interest. Then Kausalya studied the heterosis and combining ability and the bottle gourd, and he combined both the yield and quality attributes of the different and the gene action with this crop. And fruit characters is the best performing hybrids are very good. And out of that, 4 hybrids, really, they are giving a very good high yield potential compared to the check. The genetic diversity studies also tomato genotypes grown under protected cultivations, because as you know, the protected cultivation is very important for us. And we don't have Indian varieties which is grown can be grown under protected condition. So in that objective, we have 35 genotypes has been evaluated with respect to this the evaluation process, where you can put in the greenhouse conditions at CPCT as well as in case of Ranchi. So selection 178 recorded highest average fruit weight compared to fruit weight and inoperability, and average fruit weight per plant each harvest and yield of fruit at 1000 square meter. And selection 69 showed to be resistance to nematode, and selection 264 was found to be superior for acidity, total carotenoids and carotene content. The genetic diversity and population structure analysis done in the Indian melon by Kakutara with Dr. H. Chaudhary, and it is the characterized the different diverse melon germplasm using morphological and molecular markers to decipher the genetic relationship and population structure among the diverse melon genotypes. There are some different groups of these particular melon groups has been taken: reticulatus, indorus, and cantalupensis, which are the mainly cultivated melon germplasm. Whereas momotica, colossus, conomon, they are the this melon germplasm. So he categorized in different 4 groups, particularly with respect to the yield and other traits, particularly 11 morphological traits. Based on that, he categorized in the 4 groups. In the cluster 1, there is 25 accession having highest average fruit weight. And if you say the cluster 2, 21 accession having high TSS. Whereas in cluster 3, there are most number of days and female most number of days, and they have there is change in the female and male sex ratio. Cluster 4, they are smallest fruit length and having good smallest cavity length. So these are the things, and they have also observed in reticulous group DMM92, DMM331 having the different with respect to performance of the, and the TSS is concerned. Maturity based on days to female flowers is also concerned. Early is about 37 to 42 days, mid is 40 to 47 days, and late is 48 to 53 days. And the cluster analysis based on the morphological markers revealed in terms of all the accession across the clusters. Whereas they studied with these SSR markers, and they found that in the cluster 1 and 3, they are mainly consist of the cultivated types, whereas cluster 2, they form the distinct group of wild melon blossom. And in this case, the publications of the students is about 29, and more than 6 in the NAS rating is 21. And the students published in different journals. The honors and awards received by the faculty member, I got this Harikrishnan Sastri Memorial Award, also Vishwajit Chaudhary Memorial Award, Anil Khar Significant Contributions Award in Associative Alliums. Sabina got the best poster award during first vegetable congress at Agriculture University. Then foreign training and deputation students, and that is Vinay, he went to for NIAF CAST training program to Japan for 3 months. And the practical classes also done at IRN New Zealand, different students exposure to the practical itself. They have to do crossing, helping, and all the methods adapted here. Also the exposure visit by the PG students to Himachal Pradesh, to Palampur, and the different research station in IHBT, and there was a wonderful experience for them also. Then 59th convocations, I must thank to all of you that this is the director IRA, joint director of all research, education, extension and administration, associate dean, head of the division of vegetable science, and my
thank you Dr. Behra. So we have completed, sir, all the 4 presentation. Now I would like to invite Dr. Prasad for his comments and remarks. Sir, please.
Good evening to each one of you. Very distinguished Honorable Vice Chancellor and Director of IRA, Dr. A.K. Singh, Dean Dr. Rashmi Agarwal, Convener Madam Seema Jaggi, very distinguished professor friends of mine, and faculty from IIHR Bengaluru, students from IRA and IIHR Bengaluru, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Dr. A.K. Singh, for your kind words. Most of the accomplishments were not possible if I were not at IRA. So the entire credit for what I am today directly goes to IRA. I was a student of IRA. I was one among you till 5 years ago. At the outset, let me thank the distinguished director of IRA for giving me the chance to get reconnected with you all again. I'm very happy to see virtually each one of you. I could see many of my friends, my colleagues, and very distinguished academicians. Thank you for the opportunity, Director, Dr. A.K. Singh. And it was a wonderful journey to go through the presentations of all the four disciplines made by my friends and colleagues, Dr. Kanwarpal, Dr. Avasthi, Dr. Behra, and Dr. Jha. There were 31 students who completed their MSc and PhD this year. First of all, compliments to all the students for the excellent work that they have done. And the compliments to all the chairman, co-chairman, and the advisory committee members for sailing through the difficult times, helping the students to complete their respective theses. After going through, I doubt that we pass through a pandemic phase, because the work that was done by most of the students is exemplary and also in tune with the developments across the nations. Very excited to see the developments in floriculture, especially on haploid production in marigold, identification of SSR markers, some of the good SSR markers in roses, and the studies on leaf senescence in chrysanthemum, and the genes that are regulating the senescence in case of chrysanthemum. And equally impressed with the work that is being carried out in the fruit science and division, especially on the mutants which they are trying to evaluate for low seeded mandarins and also salt tolerance. Sex determination in papaya is a big game changer. If it can be done at the very young stages, the entire papaya industry is going to be very much benefited. I hope we'll cut the ice very soon and then come out with the kind of markers that the farmers expect, so that the huge papaya industry gets benefited. Interesting to note about the molecular studies associated with the pulp color of guava. Nowadays, the importance of guava in terms of colored varieties is increasing in the market. Most of the RTS that we consume today is from the colored guava. And the rootstock studies for sweet orange, the colchiploids in quinoa, and the new generation growth promoters. and microbial consortia that are being used for mango. These are all in tune with what is the requirement of the present day requirements of the farmers as well as the industry in terms of, especially when I say industry, in terms of guava as well as papaya. Post-harvest technology, very good progress is being reported, especially in terms of developing some dehydration products in case of capsicum. And interesting to note the hyperspectral remote sensing to be used for rice, determination of aging of rice. Probably that will also help for the rice industry. For most of the rices are artificially aged. Maybe this is a good intervention that is going to come for the industry. And very aptly oriented research of vegetable sciences, mostly towards molecular breeding approaches, mostly addressing the biotech stress, the challenges that are faced by the farmers, mostly addressing the diseases and insect pests. And almost in all the crops, either in chilies, then tomato, cucumber, then capsicum, all the research work is oriented towards addressing the biotic stresses and that too using molecular markers. And this is again going to be a very good contribution by the discipline of vegetable sciences to offer solutions for many of the abiotic stresses that the farmers face. And when we have a variety which is tolerant or resistant.
Yes, Dr. Asmi, what is to be done now?
Sir, our chairperson is summarizing the School of Horticulture Sciences presentation, sir.
Okay.
Another 2 minutes, doctor. So compliments to all the students and the faculty for encouraging the students to bring out with very good publications. In almost all the disciplines, the numbers are very encouraging. And congratulations to all the winners of the awardees, like the best student awards, then the faculty got many good recognitions. And I also take this opportunity to request Honorable Director of IRA to consider DFR as also one of the locations for your visits for the students in your future visits. And also you can depute your students for conducting their research. Maybe we are evolving at this point of time, but in years to come, we are the institute is going to be established and we'll be able to be guiding the students or helping the students in terms of pot plant production, the nursery, which are the, like, you know, the crops which where, you know, it is not possible to grow in climates like Delhi. Pune has the advantage of having the diversity of crops. So our gates are open. Will be willing to help the students for conducting the research. So thank you so much. I sign off at this point of time. I am more informed and educated with the presentations that I witnessed of the basic sciences as well as the horticulture sciences. So before I close, I would like to request my colleagues, especially in the fruits division, when they are working on the mutants of fruit crops, they maybe they can utilize the phenomic facilities that you have at IRA, not only to look for the variants, novelties, you can also look for variants which can sequester more carbon and more environmentally related to, you know, to address many other issues. And in terms of all the research work that we are doing, we should also look for the spin-offs that are coming out of our research. When we are talking about whether it is characterization of the color in case of capsicum, in terms of guava, why not extract those pigments and the nutraceutical pigments and use them for food colorants or for nutraceutical applications. Hydroponics and aeroponics are the new generation requirements of the industry. Most of the private sector is also looking towards these technologies. I think it's high time that as national institutions like IRA and DFR, we all should be thinking in going big way in terms of conducting research on hydroponics and aeroponics. With this, thank you very much, Dr. A.K. Singh, for the wonderful opportunity that you have given me, for reconnecting with all my colleagues and friends. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Prasad, for your time and valuable remarks. And that will go a long way in improving our program. And also, it's a big encouragement for students and the faculty. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your
Madam, before you formally conclude the session with word of thanks, now most of the students and the faculty members are eagerly waiting for the results of the IRI Merit Medals and Best Student of the Year 2020. The names are to be announced generally by the chairperson of the judging committee, but responsibility has been now assigned to our honorable director. So he will do the honor of announcing the results. As yesterday we witnessed excellent presentation from all the students, appreciated by jury members and especially from the chairperson of the jury. So now I request the director to do the honor of announcing the
results. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Manjaya. And this is a much, much awaited moment. For students, I wish they were in very large number. We can see 300 people are still there, but this number could probably increase soon. They may not have known that this will be announced at this point of time. It's a pleasure to announce the name of winners, and we all know that we had presentations yesterday and day before yesterday, and we had very capable jury to identify the most promising candidates for their medal award, although all students were one to one and second to none. The differences could be very minor, 1 marks, 2 marks here and there. So please don't go disheartened or disappointed. Those who presented and could not get it, you have made it to it. This particular platform itself is a big, big achievement. Now coming to the MSc program, the IRI Merit Medals go to Mr. Akshay Kumar HM from Plant Pathology. You can clap for them if they are their students. Then Ms. Nunavat Ashwani from Genetics and Plant Breeding, Mr. Tridiv Ghosh from Agricultural Physics, Ms. Sasmita Tripathi from Agronomy, Mr. Vishal Balasaheb Mahatre from Fruit Science. And the best student of the year in MSc program goes to Mr. Pratik HP from Plant Physiology. Hearty congratulations to all the winners and their teachers and guide in particular for bringing them to this stage and level of achievement. Hearty congratulations. Now, as far as PhD medals are concerned, the IRI Merit Medals go to Mr. Neeraj Buddha Lakoti from Bioinformatics, Mr. Raj Kumar Bhakar from Agricultural Physics, Mr. Kiran Karthik Raj from Soil Science and Agricultural Chemistry. Somebody is speaking. Can you please keep quiet so that people can listen? Then Mr. Darshan K. from Plant Pathology, Mr. Venkata R. Prakash Reddy from Genetics and Plant Breeding. The best, The best student of the year in PhD program goes to Mr. Saheb Pal from Vegetable Science.
Thank you.
Again, I would like to wish them hearty congratulations for excellent piece of work that they have done. I am thankful to all the jury members and chairperson of the committee for doing a great job. Thank you all very much and hearty congratulations. Somebody seems to be disappointed with the results. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. With this, we come to the end of today's program. And we will meet tomorrow at 9:30 again with the presentation of the School of Social Sciences and followed by the various award lectures. Please join in large number as you have been today with us to listen to the award winners and also the wisdom of the chair who are going to chair the award lectures as well. Thank you very much. Over from my side.
Thank you, sir. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes, from my side, I congratulate all the award winners in MSc and PhD category and all those who participated. They also have the credit.
Yes.
Thank you, Doctor. Now, Dr. Seema can finally.
In the end, it is my pleasure to propose a formal vote of thanks. So today we had total 21 presentations covering the research work of 211 students. So in this, we had 5 sessions. So first of all, I would like to thank the chairpersons of all the 5 sessions for chairing the session and for their critical remarks. Thank you so much, sir. I would like to thank the director, IRI, for being with us throughout the day and for giving his remarks on all the sessions. Thanks to Dean Madam for your guidance, to Associate Dean Dr. Manjaya for your full involvement in this, then all the speakers for making excellent presentations, all the heads of the division, other professors, faculty members, students for being with us throughout the day. Special thanks to Dr. Barman and Dr. Mishra along with their team for making all possible arrangements for this virtual program. Thank you so much. Tomorrow we'll meet at 9:30. Thank you so much. Thanks to each one of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Seema, and all other faculty members and our all resource persons who chaired the session.
Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Manjaya, and our director.